be in league with them still. So yeah, we're in more democratic times now, and that's a paradox because in one way the elite is still just as powerful as it ever was, but the mass of the people are now becoming more and more powerful, and one day those graphs will cross.
Let's talk about the killing of Tony Blair. Of course, the killing we're talking about is financial killing. Blair was infamous for being a failed property speculator before he got into politics. You know, he bought some properties.
Bought at the top and sold at the bottom. Yeah.
Yeah. So how did this failed property speculator? How did he suddenly become so wealthy? What was this magic there?
Well, I think it's. By the way, the title of the movie is a triple entendre. Blair killed the Labour Party, killed a million people, and is making a killing.
In Iraq, referring to
yes, that. Iraq and Afghanistan and elsewhere. But the killing that he's making, because he always believed in the profits rather than the profits, peace be upon them. And he is making a killing now by cashing in on the crimes that he committed earlier. And this is an incentive too, given by big capitalist corporations and brutal dictatorships as an inducement to the existing crop of politicians. Today's leaders can look forward to the kind of life of Riley that Tony Blair is now living, at least in financial terms. So it's a good inducement to them to follow policies that don't challenge the big power and don't challenge the financial power of the oligarchy.
It seems like in politics that the goal used to have a crowning achievement, maybe be the prime minister or the president of the United States. Now it's just something on your resume, on your way to getting your real job that you really want, where it's Bill Clinton or Tony Blair or Barack Obama seems like a completely empty suit, just using the office to get to his real job and his real big bucks on the other end.
It's absolutely right. British prime ministers, indeed senior ministers, used to retire with a title to the countryside and sedately, sagely give us their advice from time to time, usually with a speech in the House of Lords. Nowadays, as you say, there's a revolving door. You come out of Downing Street, out of the Cabinet Office, and into the corporate offices. And in Blair's case, onto the payroll of a series of dictatorships which become ever more laughable, the latest one being Mongolia. Mr. Tony Blair is now the consultant to the Sovereign Wealth Fund of Mongolia, as well as Kuwait and many other countries that I should save for the documentary. So it's a double whammy, really. We suffered from the bad policies that he followed whilst in office, and he is now profiting mightily from those bad policies. So the man that lost money on a property in Islington, which was very hard to do, is now earning something like £25 million per year.
This phrase, blood for oil, which we heard during the Iraq War, and Blair vehemently denied it. And yet, if you look at his post-Iraq War track record, it seems pretty much his entire wealth derives from oil that some argue comes exactly from blood or from war. Was this a case of, you know, what's done a lot of times is you'll just spit back at somebody what they accuse you of being in the hopes that they'll somehow turn it around. Yeah. I mean, isn't this exactly blood for oil, is my question?
Well, in Shakespeare's Macbeth, of course, Lady Macbeth looks at this damned spot which all the perfumes of Arabia will not expunge. And I think that Blair has that spot. In her case, it was a red spot. His case, it's a black spot, but stained with red. It's oil, it's banking, it's the dictatorships that themselves have a sovereign wealth fund because of oil, and he is literally raking it in and hiding it behind thick hedges of obscurity with offshore locations and a labyrinth of financial layers and protections. But we are on his trail, and we intend to get to the bottom of his wealth. We want to count it, and we want to adumbrate the sources of it.
This project, The Killing of Tony Blair, it's on Kickstarter. People can go to the website right now, participate in underwriting and financing this project. So from what I'm hearing, George, you're going to be doing a little traveling. You're going to be going to these countries. Is that correct?
Well, we hope to get a location. It depends partly on the budget. We've set $150,000 as the ultimate budget for this documentary. We need to raise $50,000 from Kickstarter. You know how it works. If you don't raise the whole 50, you don't get anything at all. So we need to reach 50 to kickstart the project. But the more budget we get, the more traveling we can do to the scene of the crimes. But we need library footage. We need people's anecdotes. If you've got any pictures or any video or any testimony that you want to give about the killings of Tony Blair, then we'd like to hear them. You can supply them to us, and who knows, they might make it onto the picture. By the way, everyone who gives on Kickstarter, even £5, will get their name at the end of the film, there forever, as one of the people who made this documentary.
Historical documentary.
Yeah, I think, I hope it could be a turning point.
Fantastic. Now, let me just talk about Blair again. You know, one of the stories that I picked up on, picked up from the Financial Times, actually, was the story was that Prince Bandar was in his office at number 10 Downing Street and said that if he didn't get the serious fraud office in this country to call off the slush fund scandal between the British Aerospace and Saudi Arabia, that he could not guarantee that another 7/7 bus bombing wouldn't occur in London. So here you have Prince Bandar of Saudi Arabia threatening a sitting prime minister with an act of terror. And he folded like a cheap tent. I mean, that was outrageous. In this world, how does something like that happen where a prime minister is threatened in his office and there's not more made of it?
By a potentate elected by no one, presiding over, one of the group presiding over, the unfreest country in the world. This dictatorship of Saudi Arabia swaggers around the world threatening all sorts of people. There are stories circulating that Bandar is threatening other people with the same kind of thing. And I don't know if it's true, I wasn't there, but I do know that Saudi Arabia is the source of a great deal of the Islamist extremism in the world. Their extreme Wahhabi ideology is the ideology of those who cut open people's chests and eat their hearts on video.
Okay, so terrorism is something that this country is trying to fight, and yet there seems to be a remarkable disconnect here, because here they were threatened with an act of terrorism from a Saudi in the number 10 Downing Street, but then again, we just had an incident where the partner of Glenn Greenwald, David Miranda, right here at Heathrow Airport, is held for 9 hours under the anti-terrorism law. Bandar, he's free. Bandar can walk away and just continue the slush fund.
Sure.
Somebody is a journalist is a terrorist. You're sitting, you know, in the House of Parliament right now for Bradford West. What was your reaction to that?
Well, I once asked David Cameron quite recently, what's the difference between the Al-Qaeda we're funding in Syria and the Al-Qaeda that we're fighting in Mali at the time the British and the French invaded Mali just a few months ago? And of course, answer came there none, for there is no answer. People who are blowing the whistle about crimes committed by the states like this one and by the United States are criminalized, hunted down. Bradley Manning got 35 years. Whilst Bandar can threaten people with terrorism and walk down a red carpet back to his private jet at Heathrow to fly out.
Maybe you can fill in some gaps in a story that I'm very intrigued with. You know, speaking of Tony Blair, they went to Libya, they met with Colonel Gaddafi, they reintroduced him, kind of had a coming out party after absolving him of the Pan Am bombing situation.
Yes.
He's going to rejoin the community. He then introduced, Tony Blair did, his sovereign wealth fund to J.P. Morgan and Goldman Sachs, who proceeded to blow it, who lost billions of that. Yeah. And shortly thereafter was his comeuppance. So Tony Blair, seemingly working at that time as an advisor to J.P. Morgan, is using what I would call financial terrorism to create a political outcome in these regions. And we've had this conversation before. I equate what these bankers do with their derivatives and their debt that they inject into these locations for a tremendous direct, even in their own countries, as being predatory in a sense. And that the bankers here in this country need to be prosecuted either as a racket or as predators on the system, not just getting these fines, as they're constantly getting fines, civil fines. They need to be criminally indicted and criminally
prosecuted. They need to be behind bars, yeah. I think that's right. As long as fines are all that happens, then the corporations can absorb that. It's kind of a tax write-off. But the until bankers feel that cell door shutting after them, then it will not discourage them from the kind of activities that you have been so ruthless in pursuing. And if I'm ever the mayor of London, you'll be my finance economic czar. We'll be sitting here and they'll be jumping in the river.
Well, I saw it in William Hill. On the, other side. The odds of you becoming mayor of London have jumped.
I'm third favorite.
It was,
and 20, I haven't
it was
even
you're
declared.
25 to 1 now.
25 to 1.
And there isn't a mysterious blank spot at the bottom where the possibility of you running under Labour.
It says that the market will be void if I'm the Labour candidate, which has encouraged a lot of interesting speculation. But the other government party, the Liberal Democrats, are 66 to 1. So I've clearly got a better chance than them if I decide to run. But if I did, part of the manifesto would be to clean up this place over the river, which is a nest of malfeasance, and where white-collar criminals swan around in their Lamborghinis on their big bonuses, pursuing all sorts of financial malpractice, which has brought the country to the edge of ruin, and not just this country. But on the Gaddafi point, Saif al-Islam al-Gaddafi, the favorite son of the late dictator, was ensconced here in London. He was in and out of number 10 Downing Street. Mr. Blair even helped him with his PhD. And the London School of Economics became, for a brief and inglorious period, the Libyan School of Economics, when Saif was ensconced there and giving them money. The green room in the London School of Economics was effectively inspired by him. This grisly story of the Blairs and the Gaddafis will be an important centerpiece of the documentary that I am making.
The Killing of Tony Blair.
Indeed.
They can participate in funding it and being a part of it on Kickstarter.
Kickstarter.com.
Look it up. George Galloway, thanks so much for our time, but thanks for being on the Kaiser Report.
Thank you, Max. Thanks always.
All right, that's going to do it for this edition of